Today, I will explain how to interpret the correlation matrix of the estimates. The correlation matrix of the estimates is displayed in the Result tab, and it is calculated when clicking on the task Standard Errors. In practice, this task calculates the variance-covariance matrix, which can be found in the Result folder. The diagonal terms of the variance-covariance matrix are used to calculate the standard errors according to this formula here. And the off-diagonal terms are used to calculate the correlation between each pair of population parameters. Note that this matrix represents the correlations between the population parameter estimates, and it has nothing to do with the correlation of the random effects. The correlation matrix can be calculated using the stochastic approximation or the linearization according to the toggle here. My personal experience is that it is often easier to see the correlations between estimates using the linearization method. The correlation matrix of the estimates can be used to detect overparameterizations of the model. If the correlation between two parameters is close to 1 or minus 1, then it means that these two parameters have identical or opposite effects on the predictions. If this is the case, then it will be very difficult to estimate these two parameters because several sets of values will lead to the same prediction and therefore to the same likelihood. In this display, we have a color code black, yellow, orange, and red to quickly spot the high positive or negative correlations. The values here at the bottom are the minimum eigenvalue of the matrix, the maximum one, and the ratio of the two. The ratio is also often called condition number. The rule of thumb is the following. If the condition number is smaller than 100, then everything is probably okay. If it's between 100 and 1000, then it deserves closer investigation. And above 1000, then the model is very likely to be overparameterized. Let's have a look at an example. I'm working with the following PK dataset, which clearly depicts nonlinear elimination. If I use the Michaelis-Menten approximation of the target-mediated drug disposition models, then the correlation matrix looks like this and everything is fine. If, on the opposite, I'm using the approximation with constant total receptor and irreversible binding, then in the correlation matrix, I see that I have a very strong negative correlation between R0, the initial receptor concentration, and Kint, the internalization rate. And I also have a pretty large condition number. So to understand what is going on more precisely, I'm gonna here click Use Last Estimates, Save, and then Export to ML Explorer. And here I'm gonna choose to simulate the last individual, so I'm going to reuse the design of the last individual of my dataset, and I click OK. This is going to open ML Explorer, and in this script here, I have nothing to change. I can just run it to perform a simulation using the design of the individual I have selected and the typical population parameter values. On axis, I can choose to go to log scale, and then to add a reference to freeze what I have on the screen here. Now let's see what are the impact of R0 and Kint. So if I increase R0, I'm modifying the curve, the prediction in this way. And I can see that if I decrease Kint, I can come back to almost exactly the same prediction. So this means that there are several sets of parameter values for R0 and Kint that gives the same prediction. So that's another way to see that it is not possible to uniquely identify Kint and R0. A third way to see it is to run a convergence assessment. From here, I can run several times the population parameter estimation, starting from randomly picked initial values. For this project, I get the following. So we see that all parameters converge to a clear value, except Kint pop and R0 pop. Sometimes K int is small and R0 is large, and sometimes k int is large and R0 is small. So here too we see that several sets of values for R0 pop and k int pop give the same results. So the correlation matrix of the estimates, the manual sensitivity analysis with MLExplore, and the convergence assessment all hint to an overparametrization of this model. So I can choose to work with a simpler model, for instance the Michaelis-Menten TMDD approximation, or fix one of the parameter values. Another typical example I would like to show you is the following. So this is a Theophylline project from the demos, and I have chosen a combined one residual error model. In the results, I see I have a very strong correlation between A and B, the two parameters of the residual error model. If this is the case, then it often helps to change for a combined two error model, which has a different formula. So to conclude, it is very easy to see the high correlations thanks to the color code in the matrix, so don't hesitate to use this information to improve your model. You can find this information also online. See you next week.